Terry Gilliam desprèn entusiasme i jovialitat, tot i apropar-se ja als 80 anys. El director de pel·lícules com Brasil, 12 micos o El rei pescador destaca també per ser l'únic membre nord-americà d'un dels grups de comedians més mítics de tots els temps, els britànics Monty Python. Gilliam hi va començar treballant com a animador en el seu programa de la BBC, The Flying Circus.
Monty Python, The Flying Circus.
It was wonderful because I was the odd man out in Python. I was the American. They were all British, brilliant actor performers, brilliant writers, and I got to do animation. So everything else was judged by the group, but not my stuff. I would turn up on the day of the show with a can of film under my arms, boom, boom. And so in many ways I was the freest of all the Pythons to do exactly what I wanted to do. The fact it worked, the interesting thing that an American comes to Britain and somehow my sense of humor and their sense of humor matched.
Aha! Les seves originals i surreals animacions s'intercalaven entre els absurds esquetxos dels humoristes, una feina que Gilliam feia de manera totalment artesanal.
Well, it was the only way I could do it, and the only way I could work quickly and cheaply was cutting out things, moving them around. So it was very primitive. And I think in Britain, nobody had seen that style of animation. Cut-out animation. So I guess I became quite famous very quickly because nobody knew about it. I was really just inventing as I went along, learning, because I never studied animation.
I'd like to have an argument, please.
Certainly. It's 50 years this year since we began. We seem to still be, I hate the word respected, but we're certainly liked. But I don't see many people doing the kind of humor we were doing, because we could say anything. Now it's very politically correct. Everybody's very frightened of offending somebody. The whole point of humor is very offend somebody. It's just about finding what is absurd in the world. It's really what it's about. We have to be able to make fun of each other. We don't want to kill each other, but it's very important to keep making fun of each other.
Després passaria a fer d'actor i guionista també a les pel·lícules del grup.
Holy Grail was a big success, but what was interesting, and that's what Spain was interesting, because Life of Brian came out just after the end of Franco. Our timing was perfect. Suddenly, drugs, rock and roll, sex opened up in Spain, and also Monty Python. So I was always very impressed with how people here seem to be so excited by Python, more than other places.
Always look on the right side of life.
With Life of Brian, we were dealing with religion. We were dealing with so many important things. We were even ahead of the world of transitional identity. I want to be called Loretta. Why do you want to be called Loretta? I want to be a woman.
I want to be a woman. From now on, I want you all to call me Loretta.
Why do you want to be a woman? I want to have babies. You can't have babies. You don't have a womb. We were talking about what people are talking about now, 30 years ago.
Més tard, Gilliam va començar a fer les seves pròpies pel·lícules i a gestar un estil únic. En tots els seus films s'explora la relació entre realitat i ficció i es presenten personatges que intenten fugir de la societat a través de la imaginació.
That's the way I approach life. I'm trying to escape reality 24 hours a day. But the fact is, in all of these films, the character never escapes reality. It's always the tension between fantasy, imagination, and reality.
Una de les seves creacions més personals i ambicioses és Brasil, on descriu un món futurista, mega burocratitzat i opressiu per on transita el seu somiador protagonista.
Brazil seems to be the most important movie I ever made. Financially, it was not a success. Over the years, it made its money back and even more money was made. But at the time, the box office, I remember with Brazil, when we would screen the film, literally, by the end of the film, half the audience had left. And now it's a classic, it's a masterpiece. The problem is if you do something that's different than the norm, people take a long time to begin to understand what you're saying and how you're saying it. I think my films all end up being appreciated years later, just like good wine. Forgive
me! Als anys 90, Gilliam torna als Estats Units, on roda alguns dels seus films de més èxit.
I like New York in June.
I went to the US, I went back to my country. I also started making movies that I didn't write. And these were the most successful movies of my life. I never learned the fact that I should just do other people's movies. Suddenly I find I'm in America, I'm working with big stars, I've got a studio behind, so I've got the money that I don't normally have. And once a studio spends money to make a film, they spend even more money to promote the film, so.
Important role in returning the human race to the surface of the earth.
12 Monkeys, again, was pretty easy. Once I have, you know, Bruce Willis and Brad Pitt, people seem to be happy to let me keep going to work. I think what was interesting is I cast Bruce to play the character he played, which was almost the opposite of the kind of characters he'd been playing. He'd been diehard, he'd been very verbal. And suddenly I've got him playing a character that's all introspective. It's all, he's doing very little.
What I need to do is make a telephone call.
And then I met Brad Pitt, who wanted to be in the movie, but he wanted to play the part Bruce Willis was already playing. And Brad, up to that point, he certainly had not been a motor mouth. In 12 Monkeys, the first scene with Brad is his first day of work, and he kind of explodes on the screen. He's fantastic.
If you don't buy things, toilet paper, new cars, computerized blenders, electrically operated sexual devices.
Una altra peculiaritat de les pel·lícules de Terry Gilliam és que transmeten una visió pertorbadora i fosca del món, cosa que contrasta amb la seva personalitat.
I don't know what it is, because I'm very gregarious. I'm generally pretty optimistic. I'm not frightened of anything, but once I've got a camera, I'm allowed to explore other things. I mean, something like Tideland, it was all about doing a film about this little girl in a very complex and difficult situation, and yet she survives. I think all my films are about surviving in one way or another.
Capítol a part, necessita la seva aventura quixotesca per fer una adaptació del Quixot. Va tenir la idea fa gairebé 3 dècades, però les complicacions i els contratemps han estat infinits. El documental Lost in La Mancha, per exemple, explica el rodatge frustrat del primer intent de Gilliam d'adaptar la novel·la de Cervantes.
Quixote is a disease, and it's communicable. And if you're caught and you suddenly come down with Quixote-itis, your life is consumed.
Finalment, l'any passat, la pel·lícula es va fer realitat.
Don Quixote de la Mancha.
He's an extraordinary character because he, in his madness, is reinventing the world, transforming the world into a place of chivalry, knighthood, romance, beauty. Of course, it's not that. And of course, he's constantly knocked down. And then he constantly gets up again. I think that's what impresses me, his resilience. He will not give up. And that's kind of what I became. And everybody, all the reasonable, sensible, intelligent people in my life says, stop. No. So that actually drove me to continue because I don't want to be a reasonable person. I want to prove the impossible. And I suppose we did. We made the film.